Everybody, I'm your host, Dr. Eric Skansen, and again, welcome to Talent Ed, the podcast that intersects education and talent and brings you a carefully curated best of the best. As I said, we have a very special guest today joining us. He's a coach, he's a mentor, he's an embodiment of sportsmanship with a career record of 428 wins and 221 losses. Multiple Coach of the Year awards and a National Sportsmanship Award. True legend in the world of coaching. Please welcome everybody, Coach Jim Johnson. Coach Jim, do you mind if I call you Coach Jim?
Absolutely, Eric. I always tell people that I've been called a lot worse, but Coach to me is an honor. So thank you.
It's an honor. Well, Coach Jim, tell us about yourself. Give us a little brief background. I mean, most people, when they're going to be searching you out and finding this video, they're going to know a little bit. But tell us who you are, Jim. What do you stand for?
Yeah, so I grew up in a very sports dominated family. I fell in love with all sports, but basketball became my love in high school, and a lot of that had to do with because my father was my high school basketball coach, so that was pretty cool. My mom and dad were both educators, so it's something that I was the oldest of six, and the oldest and the youngest were the only two that went into education. So we did follow, two of us anyways, followed our footsteps of our parents. And I got into coaching and teaching, and I bounced around early in my career, but at 25 years old, which is pretty young, I landed my first full-time teaching job and full-time basketball. I was the head coach at a school about 20 minutes from where I grew up, and I was excited. I had been successful as a junior varsity coach for a couple of years. Of course, I thought I knew everything about coaching, and I did such a great job, Eric, that I led the team to 17 consecutive losses. I after the season, I met with the administration, and they decided that they wanted to go in another direction. So I was on an interim position. So it was a pretty humbling start to my career. Well, you know, one of the things I learned is after I had some scars from that is I realized that, you know, when everybody hits adversity, but the big thing is how do you handle it and respond to it? And fortunately, that became a motivator that I wanted to prove that I could be a successful coach. And the other thing is it really opened my eyes up that I had to learn a lot about how to be a better educator as a teacher and a coach. That's when I started to really study leadership. And I became a very avid reader. I listened to audio programs. I still do to this day. Because leadership to me is the foundation. If you can lead better, it usually builds a team culture. I know from yourself being a leader for a long time that how important school culture, team culture is. And those are the things I really try to. And the other thing is I want to inspire people. You know, I used to give my players a quote every single day. We had a theme of the week, for example, the theme might be attitude. And I would give them a quote on attitude every day or teamwork or, you know, work ethic, you know, all the things that we're trying to teach. And the one thing I found that was so great, you know, with the message that I try to share with people, and certainly I was fortunate to be part of a story that blew up all over the world that we can talk a little bit about, but is that, you know, people need to be inspired and they have to be taught. And that's the great thing about education is that as a teacher and a coach, you know, you should be looking to teach and inspire every day. And if you can do that, then you're doing something special for the young people you're trying to make an impact on.
I love that. I love that. Because I would guess any coach you talk to, I mean, it certainly is not money, at least not at the high school level. I mean, it's a pretty abysmal dollar hourly rate when you look at what it takes to do coaching. So it really is about those connections and leadership and grooming, you know, the next leaders in your communities and your schools. Speaking of which, let's talk about this special story. There's a gentleman named J-Mac. Tell us the abbreviated version. I don't want you to give away the keys to the kingdom here, but I think it is worth just a little snippet of this amazing story that kind of led you to, what do we say? Infamous? Famous?
Well, I hope famous for the good reasons, but anyways, Jason, J-Mac, as everybody knows him now, is on the autism spectrum, and he tried out in our basketball program as a sophomore for the junior varsity. I was the varsity coach, and he didn't make the team, but my JV coach really recognized that he had a lot of the ingredients we were looking for of the people we wanted in our program. So he offered him the team manager's job. And I was just starting to get to know him a little bit, but he would come to, you know, in our situation, our JV and varsity games were back to back. So he was on the bench for both games. So I was starting to get to know him, and I just loved his passion and his enthusiasm and how much he wanted to help the team any way he could. But what made Jason unique for me was not that he was very small and he was on the autism spectrum and he had learning disabilities, but his heart and his passion and his desire to be the best he could be. Because, Eric, he ended up trying out for our team for three consecutive years. But what made him really different was that he came to everything in the off season. And we really established a bond. And so he tried out as a junior for the varsity, didn't make it, served as our team manager. And then his senior year, he tries out again. And, you know, our program was really good. And so I knew he wasn't going to be good enough. But, you know, his senior year, I told him I wanted to give him a gift for his commitment and his loyalty to our program. And I said, for the gift, I want to give him a uniform for our final home game where we honor the seniors. And that's what I did. And I kid them, though, that I would say periodically during the season, he would ask me about that uniform. And of course, I define periodically as about every other day. Pumped up about that uniform idea. Well, the crazy thing is I wrote a book about it called A Coach and a Miracle, because the ironic thing of that season is we were supposed to have a very good team, but we had a really divisive situation. And if anybody that's ever been on a team that didn't get along, usually you don't reach your potential, and we were struggling. But fortunately, with a lot of hard work, and Jason was kind of our inspiration in many ways, we finally came back together, and we had a good second half of the year, and Jason's going into our senior night. We actually have won 8 of our last 9 games. And we were actually we're playing for the division title. If we won, we could tie for the title. And so the game, you know, to see Jason before the game embrace his parents in uniform, although it was 52, was way too big. Usually it was that number's for a center. Jason's like 920 pounds, but he didn't care. And with about 4 minutes to go, I thought the timer's right. And I, got him in the game, and the place just exploded. A little side light that just touched my heart and has touched a lot of people. The video I show as part of my presentation is that when he got on the game, our student body, they call themselves the six men, they gave a standing ovation. But what was so cool, one of our parents made these placards of Jason's face and put them on paint sticks, and they showed that. And I had no idea. Jason had no idea. So I usually pretty macho guy. You normally don't cry at a basketball game, especially a game I'm coaching. Well, I'm so overwhelmed with emotion. I sit down and tears are literally flowing down my face. Now, Jason's in his first game. The first time he touches the ball, he gets a 3-pointer. He lets it go. The crowd all stands in anticipation. Eric, it misses by like 6 feet. And as I kid people, being in the public schools for over 3 decades, I know you're not supposed to pray in the public schools, but I was praying, dear God, please help me.
Let one go in.
So the second possession, he actually got a shorter shot, and this time it hit the rim. So I'm like, all right, God's starting to listen. We're getting closer. In the third possession, he shoots another 3, and this time, magic. It goes in. The place explodes, and it's pure bedlam. And I just was so touched. I'm like, oh, I'm thinking to myself, God must be a basketball fan. Not only has Jason scored, he's got a 3-pointer. I can't get any better than this, right? Wrong. Well, for the next 3 minutes, and I kid your listeners not, Jason used to sign his name, Jason J. Mac Kobe McElwain, because Kobe. He loved Kobe Bryant. Well, what happened was I'm going to come back and finish the game. But 5 months after that game, Jason's up for the ESPY, for the greatest sports moment of the year. If people don't know the ESPY, that's kind of the Oscars of sports. And it's in California. And I kid you not, one of the other finalists for the same award was his idol, Kobe Bryant. Kobe had scored 81 points in an NBA game that year. He's up for the same award. So Jason meets his idol and beats him out for the ESPY. Well, how did he do that? Well, after making that first three, he makes another three. And then he makes another basket where his foot is on the line and the place is just going crazy. And I'll close with this, is he ends up ending the game by making a three-pointer about 2 feet behind the arc at the buzzer. It didn't win the game, although if we get a movie someday, they probably
they might change the script on that one. Yeah.
But the place just when he makes the final three at the buzzer, the place just runs on the court like the movie Rudy, and our players put him up on their shoulders.
Oh, fun.
Forget that. And the one thing I'll say is, I had no idea how many points he has. And our public address announcer comes on and says, the leading scorer for the Trojans tonight, J-Mac, with 20 points, including 6 three-pointers.
Dropped 6 three-pointers in 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Wow.
The two things I'll share very quickly is one of the huge lessons was, you know, that I'm real big in leadership on shining the light on others. And what was so cool, you talk about the essence of teamwork, is the four players on the court that night, I never asked them to pass on the ball. They did that out of their own heart. And that's what made it so powerful. And then the last thing, you talk about what a great lesson in humility. Because after that game, we had never won our Section 5 championship, which was a big deal in our area. I had taken six teams to the semifinals, losing all six. And Jason's ultimate dream was he wanted to be part of a Section 5 championship team. And 4 weeks later after that game, in front of our arena that seats about 10,000, sold out, we ended up winning our first Section 5 championship. Wow. And the crazy thing is, in interviews after our season, I was often interviewed with Jason. And people would ask, hey, Jason, what was the best thing about your senior season? Of course, thinking he's going to share his game. And he'd say, well, there's no questions. Winning the Section 5 championship was the best thing season. It was such a great lesson for me as an educator, because as much as, you know, my dream to be a coach of a Section 5 champion, the greatest thing that ever happened in my coaching career was Jason's night, because of shining the light and having a special opportunity for a young man. To me, that's wow. The best thing you can do as a teacher and a coach. So,
Coach Johnson, I just love that story. I've heard you tell it before, and hearing it again, I love it. I love it every single time I hear it or read about it or watch a video of it. And I think, you know, as we're speaking to educators, we all have an idea of our own J-Mac, you know, our own J-Mac who is just a good, good human, trying to do so much, but comes up with some potential limitations, right? And our heart bleeds for these students. So to see J-Mac come out and follow through and to have this moment that's fuel for ages, right? That's fuel for ages. You don't need anything more than that.
Right.
You talked a little bit about this. You spoke about the importance of teamwork, goal setting. You had some players on that team who just knew the right thing to do. Do you want to share just maybe one highlighted leadership lesson you've learned throughout your coaching career? And, you know, what can we do to apply those back off the court?
Well, you know, I'll give you one is that I call about clarifying your vision. And the huge thing about that is that I think to be an effective educator, leader, you know, whatever word you want to use, is you have to clarity about who you are. And when I got clarity about my own personal mission, it really helped me make better decisions, because I got clarity of what my core values are, how I wanted to live my life. And, you know, as a leader, you know, in education, I think it gets magnified, is that, you know, there's no better leader than the person that models what they say and do consistently. And that is the thing that I think really helped me immensely as a leader, because the kids knew that what I shared I was also doing. I was saying one thing, and then, you know, like I always, like I had just a few non-negotiables, but one was being on time, because I thought if I could teach our players the importance of being on time, that's something that they'll do for the rest of their life. And, and so when doing that, but in saying that, because we would practice at 6 o'clock in the morning, which, some of our players weren't real excited about that. But I really, so I was always there at 5:30, because being on time was so essential, and really modeling things like a work ethic. And then I'm sure one other thing, I have seven keys I talk about in leadership, but is that as a leader, when we're modeling things, we have to have a plan on how we're going to build trust. And that's something because I failed in my first opportunity as a head coach, but then I had an opportunity to take over three other programs that all had been losing. We were fortunate to be able to turn around. And one of the things I taught my staff that went through our players is how we were going to build trust. And we talked about three ideas to build trust, which I think is really important because, often, Eric, I'll ask my audiences, is trust important in building a great team culture? 100%. Mm-hmm. Everybody. But then I kind of shackled when I said, well, what's your plan to build trust? And no one had, I shouldn't say no one, but majority of them, they're deer in the headlights, And that's something I think we really developed. We developed clarity of our three points on how we wanted to build trust, which helped immensely in building a successful program.
Wow. The trust leads into some other piece that I think about with you. Which is sportsmanship.
Mm-hmm.
You received a National Sportsmanship Award. Can you just tell us maybe a memorable moment where you witnessed something, some exceptional sportsmanship, either on or off the court, and how it impacted you?
Well, I just think it starts with small things on how you create a culture that you are consistently doing things that are going to build for sportsmanship. Early in my career, I was not a good model. I would get very upset with the officials, and I would yell at them. But then you're saying to your players, hey, don't be upset, that was a bad call.
Right.
And again, what changed with me is I really understand the power of modeling. So the second half of my career, you'd say majority of the officials would say the coach was always respectful. And if he did raise his voice, it was probably because they were wrong. Mm-hmm. Because I rarely would ever question them. But when I did, I probably had a good reason. And I think that, the thing that I think is so important is modeling what your behavior, like I always share this story, like one of our leadership philosophies, we call the leave a profit. So everything we touch, we want to make better or worse. And, I was teaching my players, we go into a locker room of another school and I'd walk in, and sometimes they were pristine, but there's other times where it looked like probably a locker room, it had crap on the floor and whatever. And the issue, I'd walk in, I'd see a Coke bottle and I'd pick it up and throw it on the garbage mm-hmm. can. And, those are things that, because I'll give you a great example. The best player I ever coached was my last year. He actually played in the NBA for a couple of years. And you talk about modeling. He used to, his senior year, at halftime of the JV game, he would walk over and he would clean the entire bench. He would pick up all any cups were on the floor, any jersey or tops. He'd fold them neatly, and it's not exactly sportsmanship, but it's an example of what he's trying mm-hmm. to say. And here's the greatest player I ever coached, and he was an elite player, and yet that model that he was setting. And how
that, Jim.
He would handle, when, you didn't see him lose emotion when he had a bad call against him. It was just consistent behavior. But I always say, that starts with the leader. If you're not modeling those consistent behaviors, I don't know how you expect your student athletes or your students to model those. So, that power of that model is something that I think is really important.
Well, and we often talk about good role models in our mm-hmm. programs, right? And coaching. But if you actually take a step back and just go, modeling works, Yeah. It can happen the other way as well. We forget that when we have families or we have students that come from family or homes of abuse.
Yes.
That's modeled. When we have or addictions, that's modeled. And it really does work both ways. So how do we make that intentional choice to be on the right side of right with modeling each and every day? And I love the story about the elite player who's out there cleaning up the bench, because he gets it. He gets that in order to have a culture of win-win, we've talked about win-win, in order to have that culture, like you need everybody. It's not just one person. You need everybody there.
You know, I've got to hit one real quick story, Eric, I think would be helpful for your audience, is that his young man's name was Anthony. And Anthony came from a broken home. It was a single parent. Mm. It really struggled. And you talk about a culture that we developed. So one of our rules was days of games during the week. Our players had to come in 15 minutes before school started and shoot free throws. And there was a method in my madness. Two things is I wanted to get some extra free throws in because they're important. But also, every kid on my team was on time to school. But the interesting thing, now, Anthony Sr., he was by far our best player. But his mother, good lady, but just had a lot of issues, right? She couldn't get up on time. So you talk about it takes a community, right? Anthony would stay with one of our sophomore players that lived right behind the school nights before games, so he wouldn't be late for free throws.
Wow.
You talk about, you know, building a culture where the players want to help each other out. That's pretty cool. So,
well, Coach, I got a couple of fun questions for you just to get to know you a little bit more. You know, number one, there's been some great basketball movies in our lifetime. Do you have a favorite all-time favorite basketball movie and why?
So favorite for me is Hoosiers, just because, you know, being a basketball coach, I realized that how big, you know, basketball is in Indiana, because, you know, basketball is pretty popular around the country, but there's probably not a state that has more popularity than Indiana basketball. And just to see, again, I'm a big underdog, you know, I obviously was an underdog, you know, for a lot of my career, you know, I felt like I was the underdog. We couldn't ever win that championship. And then we ended up, you know, doing quite well in the second half of my career. But what that movie did was it just showed the ups and downs of, you know, trying to this team and how that coach tried to really build a consistent culture with, you know, how he behaved, how he expected his team to behave, and to see how that one great player that wasn't, and you know, didn't even want to play at first, but because he started to develop this culture that is like, hey, I want to be part of something special. And I think, you know, as educators, that's what we're trying to develop, you know, whether it's a, you know, a team you coach or your classroom is, have you built that where they want to be part of that, you know, and that starts with, you know, you're being consistent with what you expect. And the other important thing is do you really care? You know, do you want to build relationships day in and day out? Because, you know, kids aren't stupid. They know whether you're in it for the right reasons or not. So,
well, and let's just go on record that might be one of Gene Hackman's best roles ever. I mean, he's got a deep catalog. I know that he was in the Superman movies.
Right.
Yeah. You know, name what you want, but I think we got to put Hoosiers up there as, you know, the top of his repertoire.
Yeah.
His characters.
Yeah.
Speaking of coaches, as a legendary coach, I'm gonna give you that title, legendary coach. If you could have dinner with another legendary coach, living or deceased, who would it be? And what's the one question you'd ask them?
It would be John Wooden. It's passed away. In fact, I had a parent that met John Wooden, and he was trying to connect. Obviously, he's in California. I'm in the East Coast, so it never did happen. Although I've met a couple people that got pretty close to John Wooden, and just the stories I heard. And great question with what would be the first question. I think it would just be Can I share two? Because the one would be, what people don't realize is how long it took John Wooden, which I simulate to what I went through in my career before he won his first national championship. I think he was at UCLA for 16 years before, you know, in this day and age, he probably wouldn't have stayed at UCLA.
Right, right. He would have bought out.
Right. To see, you know, how did you stay patient? Because there's a lot of pressure, you know, at that level to win a national championship. And then the other one that was so intriguing, which I really try to work with leaders, is because, you know, I always get these two questions, Eric, is how do you get to the top? And I think there's a process to that. Mm-hmm. But the more difficult question is, how do you stay at the top? And so that would be the question I would ask you, John.
Great questions.
Is how, you know, what was your process of getting to the top? But then how did you stay there? Because, I mean, when people forget, he won 10 national championships in 12 years. I mean, that's
insane. Insane.
Yeah, crazy. So,
I'm going to divert us from basketball for one question.
Sure.
What hobby or interest do you have outside of basketball that might surprise everybody?
I laugh at that because I've become a very avid tennis player, and I didn't pick it up. I actually had a trainer of our team that, you know, he did that as a side job, but his full-time job is he worked down at a health tennis club, and he started inviting me down in my late 40s to play tennis. And I had never played a lot, and I've fallen in love with the game. And what's been interesting is because of, you know, I don't really play basketball anymore, but I do play a lot of tennis, and I've gotten to the point where I'm fairly competent. And once you get something where you're pretty good at it, but I'm never going to be elite at it. Then when you start realizing, when you watch, you know, tennis on TV, it's like, oh my God, you know, and until you play a sport mm-hmm. at a decent level, you don't realize, you know,
how elite it is.
Yeah. So,
well, then my question is, is this really about a tennis career, or are you forecasting forward for the championship pickleball leagues?
You know, I do get asked a little bit because pickleball obviously has gotten so big in our
it has, yes.
And I have played it a little bit, although I got to admit, a guy that I used to play quite a bit of tennis with, and I used to always beat, he hurt his shoulder. So I reached out to him a couple months ago to see if he wanted to play some tennis. He says, well, I picked up pickleball because it's less abusive on my shoulder. Mm-hmm. You want to play pickleball? And I had never lost to him in tennis. And I lost to him 7 straight times. Pickleball.
Sounds like you got some work to do. You need to find yourself a coach.
But I think the one thing, you know, this sport that's kind of neat is, you know, picking up a sport later in life, whether tennis, pickleball, or anything else, is it helps you with mm-hmm. the competitive juices that, you know, as a coach,
There's valid research out there that says finding something to struggle in, once you've been good at a lot of things, actually brings you happiness. Like yes. there's real research on that.
Yeah.
So with tennis, or maybe it's going to be pickleball, I feel like it's going to bring you some happiness, Jim.
Yeah, I agree. No, quite. In fact, ironically, I wrote a blog about happiness recently, and I brought up tennis. So.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Well, we're gonna wrap this one up here. But before we wrap up, Coach, is there any particular message or call to action that you want to share with our listeners today?
Sure. So, you know, I love trying to make an impact. So if you're looking for someone that can inspire you, talk about team culture, I do some work on inclusion, mm-hmm. leadership. Those are the things that, you know, I really try to make an impact. And I do have quite a few free things that I do to mm-hmm. try to make an impact. So, you know, if you want to visit my website, coachjimjohnson.com, I have a free monthly newsletter. We do a free weekly blog. I have mm-hmm. a lot of video series and a lot of different things. And certainly I'd love to connect if I can make an impact and help, you know, any kind of school. I've been fortunate. I've spoken at a lot of different mm-hmm. events for schools, whether opening days or staff development days or student assemblies. I love making an impact. I'm here to help.
Well, with that, thank you, Coach Jim, for joining us today on Talent Ed. Your dedication to leadership, sportsmanship, education, it's really, really inspiring. And to all of our listeners, if you'd like to book Coach Jim Johnson for a speaking engagement or learn more about his powerful messages, you can either connect with School Pro. You can go to our website, www.schoolprok12.com, or simply check out some of the information at the end of this video. And as we sign off today, I want to tell everybody again, I remember, folks, School Pro K-12, here's how we sign off every single time. We believe in PKS, which is positive, kind, and supportive. Everybody have a great, great day. We'll be right back.